Thank you, Max, and thank you, Alexa, for welcoming me in this innovative style. And it's indeed an honor and privilege to be talking to this community of developers, techies, on the AWS Summit. And it was a joy to listen to my senior Jayesh Ranjan sir. And then Mr. Sanjeev will also speak about how using cloud, how using AWS, different government departments, different public sector units are transforming governance. We at Digital India Corporation have had several projects which are running on cloud, quite a few of them running on the AWS environment, and we have greatly benefited with the kind of services we have got, especially during the pandemic. So I convey my gratitude, my thanks to the entire AWS team for coming to our support, for helping us, for ensuring that services, critical services, as was mentioned, the Cowin or the Arogya Setu or the other public digital platforms that we are building are running, serving the people without any glitches, without any failure, and meeting the requirements of which are there in India for building solutions on scale. So I will quickly go through with regard to what our experience has been and what the concerns the government has been and what how do we ensure that more and more power, government departments, more and more states, on get them onboarded and take up implementation of public digital platforms, ensuring digital transformation with the objective of ensuring better delivery of services to people, ensuring that people are served better in this country, they are actually empowered, and they get what's their rightfully due. So these are some of the transformational digital India projects. I need to repeat the names in this audience here, but these have been at the core of ensuring digital transformation, ensuring that we are able to build solutions, the Aadhaar, the UPI, the DigiLocker, the Cowin, the Umang, all these solutions, all these platforms have been empowering citizens, empowering people. So whether it was to get the vaccination appointments or whether it was to eliminate cash transactions, ensuring that we are able to make even small value transactions easily, what UPI enables, DigiLocker. In fact, the numbers, our projects are so huge that sometimes we also get lost with regard to how many users are there. For example, DigiLocker has 125 million users and 6 billion documents on it, which is ensuring seamless exchange, ensuring that we are able to move to a paperless form of governance. So Aadhaar ensures faceless kind of governance, UPI ensures a cashless systems that we are able to build in, and DigiLocker, what it does is a paperless governance. And it allows, and with the API Setu project, which is mentioned there, it allows different government systems, different systems to talk to each other, to exchange information, to exchange data, and ensure that the citizens do not spend their valuable time in running from pillar to post or going from portal to portal. Government systems, government databases start talking to each other, exchanging information. The Ayushman Bharat Digital Health Mission, One Network for Digital Commerce, Deeksha, Bhashini, which is enabling language translation, enabling access to services in multiple Indian languages, and as we go ahead, enabling voice-enabled access to services. If Alexa can welcome us, then why can't citizens access services through a voice mode on a smartphone or even on a toll-free number? Why should people need to key in or download an app and enter data while they are accessing services? Can I not go to my app or call a toll-free number and say that what is the status of my passport? What is the status of my driving license? Where do I get a blood group of a particular thing that I want? Or where do I get a vaccination appointment? Or how do I find a doctor? Or how do I apply for a job or get a scholarship? So all these services will be enabled with the Bhashini project in due course, and that would really empower 500 million people in India who might not have the skill sets to download an app or go to a portal. So these are the projects which are enabling transformation in the true sense. Again, numbers. If you look at these sheer numbers, Aadhaar, 1.3 billion, 78 billion authentications happening in real time. GeM, the government e-marketplace, 5 million sellers there. UPI, we all know every month we are doing 140 billion transactions happen in August. GSTN, Cowin. So every project is like an order of magnitude which is much more than anywhere in the world. So whenever we design projects in India, we design it for scale, we design it for serving the 1 billion people, and that brings in the need for having reliable infrastructure, reliable cloud kind of support, so that the focus of the government departments who are implementing these projects is more on designing the applications, doing business process re-engineering, doing the coding part, improving the user interface, and not on struggling that much on how do we manage the backend infrastructure. So to that extent, whichever cloud service provider is providing the services, whether it's AWS or anyone else, it comes as a great support to the way we design our projects, the way we implement our projects. So the key features when we build public digital platforms at population scale, of course, the key feature remains is that how do we make it scalable? How do we ensure that we are able to serve each one and everyone without the quality of the service going down? The scalability becomes very important. Interoperability is a very important aspect. Like, how do we build scalable, interoperable systems so the systems are able to talk to each other? The rural development system should be able to talk to the health systems and it should be able to talk to the food and public distribution so that if there is a citizen who is accessing multiple services from multiple government agencies, he should be able to access all these services in a whole of government approach. So that requires architecting the systems, that requires designing the systems in such a way that we are able to offer the best quality of service. Security and quality remain a very important aspect. So how do we address such issues whenever we are designing such a project? So whether it was COVID or whether it was Arogya Setu, the security by design, privacy by design, these have been the core principles when we build such projects. Today, with the amount of data that we generate with all these projects, data analytics becomes a very, very important aspect. How do we use the data that's created, that's generated? How do we do data analytics? How do we kind of use it? How do we use it for building AI, ML models? So all that requires compute of the highest order and it requires to build systems that can help deliver the services that we want. Then compliance to procurement norms, saving taxpayers' money, ensuring return on investment, ensuring value becomes a very, very important aspect for all our projects. Now, what are the challenges in cloud adoption? Very often data sovereignty, very often government departments say, how do I build systems so that my data is secure? So this assurance is very much required. So this is done by having the right policies, data localization laws, and ensuring that this kind of comfort is given to customers for data sovereignty issues. Then security, avoiding vendor lock-in becomes an important aspect. Even if I go for a service provider, how do I ensure that I don't get locked in? How am I ensure that I'm able to move if I desire to do that? Skills gap is a major problem. How do I build in capacities within government to ensure that we are able to design, we are able to negotiate, we are able to engage a partner who is able to do what we need to do. And Jayashin has also mentioned, existing data center investments becomes a big problem. Sometimes we have a system running on legacy on-prem system. How do we move it to a cloud environment? How do we write off the investments which have been done? And then migrating legacy systems sometimes is also a challenge, because some investments have been done. How do we justify that we are able to migrate? Then what we are doing at DIC is for enabling cloud environment, cloud adoption, is that we are providing these services to multiple government departments by empaneling service providers, by providing cloud consulting, by providing cloud solutioning, migration, cloud management. So we have empaneled service providers, we have got the rates, so any other government department want to adopt that, it becomes easier for them to do so. So the last and not the least, I would say, is that as we go ahead and as we build more public digital platforms in the days to come, the biggest and the most important issue that remains is how do we build trust? How do we build trust between the government and the service provider? How do we build trust between the government and the citizens so that when we are offering a service to citizens, the citizens want to be assured that whatever data the government is collecting remains secure, remains protected, and it's used only for the purpose for which it is collected. When we build a solution, when we select a partner for offering cloud services or infrastructure services, a requirement remains is that what kind of quality assurance I am getting? How responsive is the service provider? In this regard, we have had very good experience, especially with the AWS team, that when we built the COVID, examples were given, wherein the teams were very responsive and we got a lot of support in building their systems. Then openness, like if something goes wrong, is my partner, is my cloud service provider is open to me if something goes, some things will go wrong in any kind of systems. But we need to be very open with regard to that. What went wrong, what do we share, how do we correct it, and how do we ensure that the same things don't reoccur. Then the transparency in costing and billing. Cloud billing and cloud something is something that we struggle with our internal finance with regard to justify. Because if I built up a public service wherein the adoption goes more and more people use it, if billions of people use it, DigiLocker today has 120 million. Tomorrow, if I go to 300 million, definitely my costings will go up. So how do I justify that? How do we explain that? That's something that we have been working out. We have been trying to resolve that. Then dependability of product during upgrades. All solutions go through upgrades. How do we ensure that we get the better quality of service as and when the service provider upgrades his services? And within the government, we need to have a mindset change, because very often the technical teams which have been used to managing on-prem systems, they sometimes feel that managing technology when they know something is around is easier. But when we go in for a cloud kind of environment, the transition happens with, instead of managing technology, we are managing services. So that mindset change is something that we are doing capacity building and trainings within the government to do that. So these are some issues which I wanted to highlight, and I'm sure with the continuing engagement, we will be able to work together and build larger systems in order to serve the people of India. Thank you.